Hello, I would like to welcome you to lecture 18 of 2FH3. We'll start in this lecture talking about magnetostatics. We'll talk today about the Biot-Savart's law, which is really equivalent to Coulomb's law in electrostatics. And we'll talk about its applications in the calculation of the magnetic field for arbitrary wires or surfaces or volumes where currents are flowing. We will be covering chapter 7 from the book of Sadiko, from pages 281 to 292. We have seen in electrostatics that the electric field resulting from a point charge is equal to Q over 4 pi epsilon r squared in the r direction. A similar fundamental law in magnetostatics is called the Biot-Savart law. And the Biot-Savart law is simply saying that the magnetic field resulting from a small element carrying current, so it's a small element, it's a wire here, sort of a wire of vector dl. So dl here is a vector. It denotes the length and direction of that wire. So here, if we consider a small element here, something like this. This is here is dl, and it carries a current I. So the Biot-Savart's law is telling you that the magnetic field resulting from such a small element is proportional to the current flowing through that wire. It's inversely proportional to the square of the distance from that element, from the element. So if I want to draw the distance to the observation point, so if I'm observing the field here, this is really the distance between them. Okay, I'm not drawing it in a very accurate way, but this is the vector r here. This is the length r. It is the length between our element and the observation point, the point at which I'm calculating the field. And the main difference between this law and Coulomb's law is the direction of the field. Before, we're saying the field is pointing in the radial direction for a point charge, correct? But now, for a current, the direction is dl close ar, where ar is a unit vector in the direction of r. So what you have to do, you have to take a cross product between the direction of dl, which is this direction here, and the direction of r, and this will give you a direction normal to the page as shown here. And this side is going to be going into the page. If you try to calculate the field at some other point here, say a point here, it's going to be flowing out from the page. So now the main fundamental difference here is the way or the direction of the magnetic field. The magnetic field encircles the current that creates it. This is a little bit different from what we have seen in electrostatics. So just to keep in mind, in order to calculate the total magnetic field resulting from any wire or from any surface or from any volume carrying element, we have to integrate the contribution resulting from this expression here. We have to, for every element, calculate the contribution, which is dl cross ar. It's proportional to the current, inversely proportional to the square of the distance. Now, as we did before in electrostatics, I don't have to use a unit vector ar. I can use a complete vector, but I divide by r cubed in that case. And the units of the magnetic field is amperes per meter. And this can be seen from this expression here, where you're multiplying ampere meter by meter squared, so it gives you ampere per meter. As I explained in the previous slide, the magnetic field encircles the current that creates it. And the direction of the magnetic field is really according to the right-hand rule. So the magnetic field will be circulating in the direction of rotation of right-hand screw, and the current will be in the direction of progress of that right-hand screw. And this is really the general relationship between the directions of current and magnetic field. So just remember all the time, it's a little bit different from electrostatics. Magnetic field always encircles the current that creates it, which is a little bit different from the electrostatics case. We have seen in the Biot-Savart law that the expression for the calculation for the field is given by this expression here. It is I dl cross ar divided by 4 pi r squared. The main term here is I dl, which is really current in amperes multiplied by a length vector, which is in meters. But the same thing will apply if we go to other type of current distributions. We have seen electrostatics. We can talk about a point charge. We can talk about surface charge. We can talk about linear charge. We can talk about volume charge. And the, all of them were really, we were able to take them down to find expression for them very similar to the one of point charge. This is exactly the same here. For example, we talked about the wire. If you have a wire, then this wire will be divided into small elements DL. And then we sum the contribution coming from every small element. And then we apply superposition. Now there is something else called current sheet. Current sheet where you have a current flowing on the surface. It's, and the current K here in this case is an ampere per meter. So if you want to draw something like this, this can be a current sheet. I'm just drawing the side view of that. And current can be flowing into the beige. So I'm going to be drawing crosses here. So the current is flowing on this sheet into the beige. It's a very thin sheet, okay? And the wind, you say that the current is a density is K ampere per meter. This means that if you take a length here of 1 meter in the cross section, then the current flowing into the beige will be one ampere. That's what this means. And because of the units, if you in Biot-Savart's law, and if you multiply ampere by meter, you get ampere meter. Here, if you multiply ampere by meter by the area, you get ampere, you get here ampere meter as well. So in order to calculate the magnetic field resulting from a current sheet, what you have to do, you have to divide this sheet into small surface elements. And then for every surface element, KDS will be equivalent to IDL in your calculations. And then you have to follow exactly the same way. You consider this as a unit current element, and then calculate the distance to the observation point. This would be R. Calculate the unit vector AR, and then proceed as the case of a thin current filament. So this is called the current sheet, and this is the first time for us to see discuss the concept of a current sheet. The same thing will happen if you are considering a volumetric current, J. And we have seen volumetric currents before when we talked about materials with finite conductivity. So if you have an electric field, electric field, and there's finite conductivity, this creates a current J. And the current J is an ampere per meter squared. But of course, if you multiply ampere per meter squared by volume, which is meter cubed, again, you get ampere meter, which is equivalent to IDL. So you can get the magnetic field resulting from a volumetric current distribution by considering every tiny small element in the Biot-Savart law, replace IDL by JDV, and then calculate the distance from this element to your observation point R, and then calculate AR, and then sum the contributions coming from your, all your volume elements. So this is pretty much what we did before in electrostatics. When we considered the case of a discrete charge, and then we assumed that every small linear element or every small surface element or every small volume element as a point charge. And then we used Coulomb's law in this case to calculate the electric field. So in general, the expression for calculating the magnetic field here for a current wire, as shown here in this one, it is given by IDL cross R over 4 pi R cubed. We agreed DL is the direction of the current. It's a tiny differential length. DL, R is the distance between the observation point and that element DL. And R is the distance between the observation point and the element. Now, this is if we're talking about a line, current flowing in a wire, sort of wire. Here, for a sheet, we have the vector K. K is the current density vector here. It's an ampere per meter. It's a vector. It has magnitude. It has direction. And in that case, we replace IDL by KDS. But K here is the vector. DS here is the scalar. So what you have to do, at every point of the surface, find the direction of K, cross product with R, which is the vector pointing to the observation point, and then divide by 4 pi r cubed, and do a surface integral. Here we are doing a surface integral. We are summing the contribution coming from every element. So if you have a surface, what you have to do, you have to divide it into small elements. If you do this, of course, numerically, this is how things should be done. And each one of them, you calculate the current flowing, and then you apply this expression here to calculate the magnetic field. If my observation point says here, then I have to calculate this distance r. So this will be the vector r, and the modulus of this one will be the distance r. Okay. So, and then I sum the contribution coming from all elements. The same thing will happen if we are talking about a current flowing in a volume. The magnetic field is a sum of contribution coming from all volumetric elements. And what you have to do, you have to, for every volumetric element, find the direction of the volumetric current density, which is in ampere per meter squared, cross product with r, and r again is the unit vector pointing from that volumetric element to the observation point, and then divide by 4 by r squared, then integrate over the volume. So these are forms of Biot-Savart's law. It allows us to calculate the field, magnetic field resulting from different type of current distributions. As a first application of the Biot-Savart law, we'll consider the classical example of finding the magnetic field of a current carrying wire. So we have a wire here. It's carrying a current. The wire is extending from point A to point B along the z-axis. There is a current I flowing in it, and we want to calculate the field at some point here, P. We apply the Biot-Savart law. We divide this wire into small elements. Every element is dl. As you can see here, dl will be dz in the z direction. But to distinguish between the region of the source, and the source here is the current, and the observation point, I denoted dl by dz dash az, and I explained this before in my lecture. In my lecture, that it's very common in electromagnetics to denote the coordinates of the source by a dash. Now, this is my observation point. It has coordinates rho a rho. We assume here it is in the xy plane, so it does not have z component for its position vector, just rho a rho. You want to find the vector r pointing from your point, from your source element, to the observation point. So you subtract rho a rho minus z dash az, and this will give you the vector r. So it is this vector pointing from here to here. It has two components, z dash in the z direction, and then rho a rho. Now we need also in the Biot-Savart expression, we need the r, the distance. The distance between the current element to the observation point, and this distance, as you could see here, is equal to z dash squared plus rho squared under the square root. So this is the expression of r. Now, a little bit different from electrostatics, we have to do a cross product between dl and r. We agreed that this is dl, dz dash az, this is r. When you do a cross product, you cross product az cross a rho. Az cross a rho gives you a phi. Az cross az will give you a zero. Any unit vector cross itself will give you a zero. So the cross product between dl and r will give you dz dash rho in the phi direction. This is the expression. So now if you put all this together, we can say that the magnetic field is a contribution coming from all differential current elements along that wire. We put everything that we drive together. This is I, this is dl cross r, and it is in the phi direction, divided by 4 by r cubed. And remember, r is square root r squared plus z dash squared. This is why you have this bracket raised to the power 3 over 2. So now what we are doing, we said that every element will create a field which is really flowing into the page. So as you can see here, very important to notice the direction of the direction of the wire here, as you can see. So this is the direction of the magnetic field here at this point. It's flowing into the page. Okay. What we have to do now, we have to sum all these contributions. All elements of the wire, they are all creating field in the phi direction as shown here. So now we have to, what remains simply to carrying out this integral, we have to integrate from z1 up to z2, dz dash, or from z1 dash to z2 dash, or from point A to point B, to get the total magnetic field. What we will do here is simply we'll define a transformation. We'll notice from this triangle here, this is rho, this is z dash, and this is square root rho squared plus z dash squared. So for any point along the wire, the ratio between rho and Z dash is an angle called alpha. Here in the beginning is called alpha 1. This is the beginning of the wire. So you can see Z dash here to rho. We can say that tan alpha 1 is equal to rho over Z dash. For any point along the wire, there is in general an angle alpha. And this angle alpha, its tangent, is equal to rho divided by Z dash. Of course, at the other end of the wire, we can see that the ratio between rho over Z dash 2, which is at the end of the wire, is equal to tan alpha 2. So what we'll do, we'll replace Z dash by rho cotan alpha. And then calculate everything in terms of alpha and integrate from alpha 1 to alpha 2. And here I have a word of warning for you. When you do this integration, remember the alpha 1 is the angle of the start of the wire. Alpha 2 is the angle at the end of the wire, and the direction of the current is what determines the direction of the wire. So the current is flowing from A to B. So at A we have angle alpha 1, at B we have angle alpha 2, and this will make a big difference when we start to solve examples. So as I said earlier, let's use the transformation. Z dash is equal to rho cotan alpha. This means that dz dash is equal to minus rho cos squared alpha d alpha. I go back to the integral, I convert the integral from z1 to z2 dh, the integral from alpha 1, which is the angle at the start of the wire, to alpha 2 is the angle at the end of the wire. I have here this I rho, I replaced the dz dash by this term, okay? And I replaced the term in the numerator, rho squared plus z dash squared to the power 3 over 2. It gives us 1 plus cotan squared, so 1 plus cotan squared becomes cos squared. Use it to power 3 over 2, so you get this y, you get cosec to the power 3. Cosec three, power 3 will cancel with cosec to the power 2, will give you 1 over cosec, which is sine. Rho cubed will cancel with rho squared, will give you 1 over rho. Remember, rho here is a constant, because I'm not integrating relative rho. Rho is the distance to the observation point, and here I'm fixing my observation point. I'm just summing the contribution over the wire at this point. And the FI here, by the way, is also a constant because I'm talking about a specific point, a specific observation point. So it's not a variable. I don't have to integrate it here. I'm just integrating over the wire. So I can take 1 over rho out. I can take 4 by out, and I can take I out. So this will give you I over 4 by rho. You are now be integrating now minus sine alpha. Cosec squared will cancel with cosec cube to give you sine. The integral of minus sine will give you cosine. You put the upper limit, so give you alpha 2, alpha 1. So this is the expression of the field resulting from a current carrying wire that makes an angle alpha 1 at the beginning of the wire and the angle alpha 2 beginning at the end of the wire with the observation point. Notice this is a line connecting the observation point to the start of the wire. This is a line connecting the observation point to the end of the wire. And this is how we define the angles alpha 1 and alpha 2. Now, if the wire is too long, then in this case, we have the simple case. We have a wire extending, say, from minus infinity to infinity, and this is my observation point. In that case, alpha 2 will go to 0. It becomes very small. Alpha 1 will become almost pi. In the limit, alpha 1 becomes pi. And in that case, what you will do, you will you replace alpha 2, cosine alpha 2 by 1, cosine alpha 1 by minus 1, so this will give you 2. Then the result for an infinite wire, the magnetic field is equal to I over 2 by rho A alpha. And there is nothing really called an infinite wire, but we can talk about a sufficiently long wire. So this wire can be sufficiently long relative to the distance from the observation point. In that case, we can consider it as an infinite wire, and this expression will be relatively accurate. So just notice the stronger the current, the stronger the magnetic field, the farther you go away from the wire, the weaker the magnetic field becomes. These are really the fundamental thing. And of course, the magnetic field encircles the current because the magnetic field is in the phi direction. It's circulating around the current carrying wire. So this figure helps summarize this result. You can see this is we have here. This is the direction of the current carrying wire. And you can see the magnetic field is circulating around it. Okay, and of course, as you go further away from the wire, the magnetic field becomes weaker because it's inversely proportional to rho. Now we'll start to see a number of examples on how to apply this law to current wires. So for the first example, we have a wire. It's extending from the point 1, 0, and 0 to the point 0, 0, and 1. We'd like to find the magnetic field at the point 0, 1, and 0 if the current going through the wire is equal to 2 amperes. So this is a case of a single wire, and would like to see how we can calculate its magnetic field. As I mentioned to you several times, it's always helpful to start by drawing a simple diagram. So here we can see this is the wire. It's extending from point A to point B. This is a point 1, 0, and 0, and this is a point 0, 0, and 1. This is where we want to calculate the field. It is a point 0, 1, and 0. Okay. So this is the expression for the current, for the magnetic field resulting from a wire with finite length. We have here a number of unknowns we have to calculate. The current is given. The current is given for us. We have to determine rho, the normal distance between the wire and the observation point. We have to determine alpha 1 at the angle at the start of the wire. Remember, this is the start because the current is flowing in this direction. So this is the angle alpha 1. I have to find the angle alpha 2. Okay, you can see this is a line connecting the observation point and the end of the wire, and this is the direction of the wire. So this is the angle alpha 2. So I have to determine alpha 1, alpha 2, and I have to determine Fi. What is the direction of the magnetic field? It is be the unit vector pointing normal. You can see this direction here. It is normal to this plane, the plane containing this line and this line. So we have to prepare all this. Now, calculating all the angles is not really that difficult. For example, if I want to calculate the cosine of the angle alpha 1, it is the angle between this line, which is line OP, and this line here, which is the line BA. So if I take a unit vector in this direction, and a unit vector in this direction, and the dot product, I get cosine alpha 1. And this cosine is expected to be negative, because from the diagram, it's obvious it's greater than 90. Now, I want to calculate the angle alpha 2. I have to find the angle between a unit vector in the direction of BA and the unit vector in the direction of BB. So I take this, I find these two unit vectors, I do a dot product, and then the angle will be cosine alpha 2. If I want to find the length through, there are many ways of finding it. The simplest way is to use the properties of cross product. Cross product, if I cross product this vector and a unit vector in this direction, the magnitude of this cross product will give me the magnitude of the vector AP sine the angle alpha 1. But this AB sine the angle alpha 1 is nothing but this length, which I'm looking for, which is rho. So if I take the modulus of that, so what I will have, I'll have to take the modulus of that, and this should give me the result I'm looking for. So what I will have to do in order to find rho is simply to find the cross product between this vector, which is AP, and the unit vector in the direction of AB, not BA, AB. And then I take the modulus of that, and this will give me this direction. How can I find the unit vector? The unit vector Fi is very simple. Cross product AP with this vector AB, and then take a unit vector, because this Fi is normal to this plane. So now I can get all what I need. I cosine alpha 2, I will do dot product between BB and BP. Cosine alpha 1, I will do dot product between AP and the vector BA. The rho, I will do a cross product between this vector here AP and the unit vector in the direction of AB, and then I will take the modulus of that. And the modulus will give me modulus AB sine alpha 1, which is the length through. The last part is the unit vector Fi, and the unit vector here is simply the unit vector normal to this plane, the plane containing these two lines. So what I will do, I will do a cross product between this vector and this vector, and I'm here, I will have to do it in order. So I will do AB cross AP in order to get the right direction. We remember the Biot-Savart law, it says DL cross R. So I'll have to start by the direction of the current, which is the direction of AB here. So we start by preparing all these quantities. The vector RBA pointing from B to A is equal to RA minus RB. this is RA, this is RB, this is a vector RBA. We have to find the vector pointing from the point B to the point P, RBB, RBP, which is RP minus RB. So this one is 0, 1, and 0, minus 0, 0, and 1, and you get this vector. We have as well to find the vector pointing from the point A to point P, which is RB minus RA, and when you subtract them, you get this answer. We agreed that the cosines are calculated through unit vectors. So cosine alpha 2, what you have to do here, you have to do a dot product between a unit vector in the direction of BA with a unit vector in the direction of BB. And because this vector here, BB and BA, each one of them has a modulus of square root 2, when I take the dot product, the square root 2 multiplied by square root 2 will give you 2. So this will give you 1 by 0 plus 0 by 1 minus 1 by minus 1. Then we know that cosine alpha 2 is equal to 1. So I just got the angle through a dot product. So to find the angle alpha 1, we do exactly the same thing. We have cosine alpha 1 is equal to the dot product between the vector BA and the vector AB. And when you do the dot product again, this one has a modulus of square root 2, this one has a modulus of square root 2. We have to dot product the unit vectors to get the cosine. So I put this in order here, and I divide by square root 2 by square root 2, which will give you 2. So the answer will be 1 minus 1, 0 plus 0, so it will give you minus 1 over 2. We have also defined rho, and we agreed that rho is nothing but modulus AP, which is really a vector, so I have to put a line underneath it here, or the vector RAP. I call it AP or RAP, it is the same thing, it's a vector pointing from A to P, sine alpha 1, which is nothing really by the modulus of the cross product between RAP and the unit vector in the direction of AB. This is AB, and it's modulus square root 2, so this y divided by the square root 2 to get a unit vector. This is RAP. If you do the cross product, AX cross AX will give you 0, AX cross AY will give you 0, AX cross 0 will give you 0, AX cross AZ will give you minus AY, but we have a negative sign, then you get AY. Then we go to the second term. I'm just doing the cross product here term by term. This is 1 in the y direction. AY cross AX will give you minus AZ, but there is a negative sign, then you get plus AZ. AY cross AY will give you 0. AY cross AZ will give you here plus AX. And this is why you have AX. And of course, you divide by square root 2. The modulus of this term is a square root of 3. So the result will be square root of 3 over square root of 2, then rho in this case equal to square root of 1.5. The last term we need is the A-phi, is a unit vector normal to the beige, and the A-phi, as we agreed, we obtain it by cross product between the vector AB and the vector AP. When you do that, and we do it in order to get phi pointing in the right direction according to the Biot-Savart law. So we already did this calculation before, actually, in the previous slide. We did it with a negative sign, and the result was AX plus AY plus AZ. So here we have to reverse the sign, so it's minus AX minus AY minus AZ, and the modulus of this one is square root 3. So if you put all this together, the current is equal to 2 divided by 4 by, this is rho, cosine alpha 2 minus cosine alpha 1 will give you 1, because it's 1 half minus 1 half. And the A phi is given by this expression. When you put all this together and see, you simplify, you get this value here for the magnetic field at the observation point. So as you can see, what matters in all these examples is the way you calculate the field, you find the normal distance from the wire, you find the two angles, alpha 1 and alpha 2, and you find the unit vector. We consider one more example. We have an L-shaped wire, so there is a current flowing here through this wire here and then through here. It's an L-shaped wire, okay? A current I is equal to 10 ampere. It's flowing from the point 0, 8, and 0 to the point 4, 0 and 0, and would like to calculate the field at the point 4, 8 and 0, which is this one here. Now we'll have to apply superposition. So we first get the current, the magnetic field resulting due to that wire, and then the magnetic field resulting due to that wire. And if you observe the Biot-Savart law and the right-hand rule, you will see that the magnetic field for both of them is actually pointing out from the beach. So here, the magnetic field for both is coming out from the beach. So it is in the Z direction. So we know we don't have to worry about calculating Fi. Fi for both of them is normal to the beach with Z direction. I have to now to calculate Rho 1, which is the distance from the first wire, which is actually very easy to see, it's 8. Rho 2, which is the distance from the second wire, which is 4. I have to calculate the two angles, alpha 1 and alpha 2, for each one of these two wires. As I explained earlier, it's very important to start by drawing a simple diagram. I will call this segment the first segment 1, and I will call this segment the second segment 2. I will call this point A, and I will call this point B. You can see this is the first wire here, so this is the angle alpha 1 1. This is the first angle of the first wire. This is the second angle of the first wire, alpha 2 1. Now we have to calculate two angles as well respect to the other one. So this is the first angle alpha 1 2 for the second wire. This is the second angle relative to the second wire. So I have to calculate all these angles, and then I will apply superposition to get the field. Really, I have many of the data. I know that rho 1 is equal to 8, normal distance from the first wire. I know that rho 2 is equal to 4. This is given. I know A5 for both of them is AZ. What I need about to find here is rho 1, alpha 1, alpha 2 for both of them. The angle alpha 1, 1 is not that difficult. We can do a dot product between this vector, a unit vector in this direction, and the unit vector in this direction. So we'll have to multiply the position vector of A with a negative sign and find the unit vector here. This unit vector, of course, is in the minus AX direction. This minus AX, and we have to find the unit vector in this direction. If we do a dot product, we find the cosine of this angle. Cosine of this angle is 0 because it's 90 degrees. Now, to find the cosine of the angle alpha 2, 2, again, you have to do a dot product between a unit vector in this direction, which is the OB, or the RP, unit position vector, and this position vector here, a unit vector in this direction, and this unit vector here is nothing but the AY direction. Of course, the other angle is 90 degrees, then the cosine is 0. We put all this together, we are able to obtain the answer. So, for the angle alpha 1, 1, as I explained, we multiply a unit vector in the negative of direction of the position vector of A. So, it is a unit vector in the x direction, dot the vector AOP, a unit vector in the direction of the point B. But remember, the point B has two components. It has 4 in the x direction and 8 in the y direction. And it's the modulus of this position vector is square root of 80. 64 plus 16. So this is why I divide by square root of 80. So the cosine, if you do the dot product, minus 1 by 4 gives you minus 4. The cosine is minus 4 over 80 as expected, because in this case, the angle was obviously greater than 90 degrees. So in that case, we have cosine alpha 2 1 is equal to 0 for the first wire. Cosine alpha 1 is given by this one. I added another subscript to indicate what is the wire. This is the first wire here. And rho 1 is 8, then we are ready to substitute to get the first magnetic field. So it's I over 4 by rho 1 cosine alpha 2 1 minus cosine alpha 1 1. This term is 0. This one is minus 4 over square root 80. The current is 10 amperes. The normal distance is 8. When you simplify all this, you get the value of H1. So after you divide all these terms, you get the simple answer 0.0448 in the Z direction. We do exactly the same thing for the second wire. The first angle of the second wire is 0 because it's 90 degrees. The second angle, we have to do a dot product between a position, a unit vector in the direction of the point B and a unit vector in the direction of the point B. This one here is in the y direction, and this one here we already calculated it. So when you calculate, you get 1 multiplied by 8, so you get 8 over square root 80. And the angle normal distance, as we said before, from the second wire is 4. This is the normal distance from between my observation point and the second wire. So we are now ready to calculate H2 as well. So for H2, this is the expression. It's I over 4 by root 2 cosine alpha 2 2 minus cosine alpha 1 2. We agree that this term here is 0. in the beginning of the second wire, cosine is, the angle is 90 degrees, so this term is 0. This one we already calculated. If you simplify this, you multiply 80 by 4 by 4 by 80. Remember, normal distance is 4. So you get 0.177948 AZ. Both fields are pointing outward from the page in Z direction, so they do add up. The total magnetic field is equal to the magnetic field of the first wire plus the magnetic field of the second wire, and when you sum them, you get 0.2243 AZ ampere per meter, or you can put it as 222 in the AZ milliampere per meter. So this explains the concept of superposition do apply here as well in magnetostatics.